durante muchos años ha trabajado para el Museo Arqueológico de Alicante, arqueólogo subacuático. Subacuático no. Ah, perdón, yo pensaba que. Ya, ya. Perdón. Dado tu dedicación, sí, pues yo pensaba que. Sí, sí.
No, nada, bueno, pues como bien comenta, bueno, me dedico a esto de la investigación de la cuestión náutica, pues bueno, hace ya muchos años. Mis orígenes parten de la aviación, aunque parezca curioso, soy comandante de aviación retirado y bueno, pues estudié historia en la Universidad de Alicante, posteriormente, pues en vista de que lo que yo buscaba no se daba en el ámbito universitario, al menos de la que yo estaba, pues bueno, pasé a restauración arqueológica. Y bueno, pues esto me ha ido derivando poco a poco pues al estudio de los barcos, pues como herramientas, ¿no? Para comprender un poquito la historia de nuestra marina y de nuestra construcción naval. Cosa compleja en base a lo que ahora pues intentaré leer e intentaré pues bueno, pues sintetizar en el tiempo que disponemos para hacer una visión conjunta bastante amplia. Cuando se me invitó a este congreso, en el que observo que
this conference where of course I see that participants are very interested in the topic that we are covering, I thought, well, I'm going to be speaking about maybe more technical aspects, but I didn't really know if that would be okay or if I'd rather carry out a review of the existing papers and articles, or if I'd rather go for a review of the whole of the history and everything we know about archaeological remains, which are not many, really, to cover such a wide period in time. So I didn't really know how or what standpoint to take. Maybe a more iconic review would be timely. So I'm going to try and develop all these things in my presentation, which I'm going to read. Let me first of all thank Xavier Alberdi and Albaola's team and the organizers of this conference for inviting me here in order to analyze the technological context of Nao Victoria. The piece of work that I'm presenting here it concentrates on 1492, a transition from the Middle Ages to
las carreras oceánicas encabezadas con el descubrimiento y posterior colonización de las nuevas tierras.
Colonization of the new land beyond the well-known limits of the
Tenebrous
Sea. The people from Aragon, Castilla, Genoa, and Portugal wandered the seas, controlling the seas. And the kingdoms of Castilla and Portugal would concentrate all the state-of-the-art knowledge. This would have an influence in shipbuilding, which traditions were associated to the geography of the Iberian Peninsula that is located in the Atlantic Ocean. And it is also a natural gate to access the Mediterranean Sea, which is a sea that was where the mainly the maritime activity would carry on had been occurring from the old ages to the modern times. It would be daring speaking just like that about vessels. We need to be able and fully aware of the complexity of shipbuildings at the time in the Iberian Peninsula. Let's concentrate on the vessel as in order to explain the expansion that occurred around the sea. Let's wonder how were the vessels that were used coverage.
Y aunque la respuesta pueda parecer a primera vista conforme a la realidad, nada podemos decir salvo lo conocido a través de la historia.
Not say many things except for things we know from history and very little number of remains coming from the wrecks we found. This is going to be enabling us to come up with a sketch of what happened in other time. There could be a second answer to the question. We could also think that we know many things, taking into consideration the high number of articles published, where the authors provide their viewpoints, hypotheses, and conclusions on the basis of the sources they have, which are three: archaeological sources, written sources, and iconic sources coming from iconography, which are larger in number and help understand the two previous sources. What we know about the vessels used in the 15th and 16th centuries comes from documentary sources that are very different, that are accessible from national archives and provincial and local archives. There's a high number of them, but we don't have much precise information in terms of shipbuilding techniques, typologies, patterns, architecture, because in none of the sources the vessels are described, and we don't really know about the dimensions of all and each of the parts. And I believe you're familiar with this concerning the Iberian Peninsula. As for the types of vessels, we could wonder which or what type of vessels. We know that in the Atlantic Sea we had naus and caravels, and rarely the carracks. First two represented 50% of the total vessels sailing our waters. I cannot ratify that in any case. As I said, carracks were rarely used. They were larger, and they were coming mainly from the Mediterranean Sea. They were coming from Italy, mainly. And here I would like to add that in 1501, the monarchy subsidized the construction of carracks that have a certain tonnage. This is just a reference, but I don't have any more reference to the existence of carracks in this specific century. And then finally, let me mention the galleons that were vessels and that used to have very different features to the ones that vessels had in late 16th century. Let's say that let me mention the Armada of Castilla del Oro. The historians don't really know how many vessels made it up. There were caravels, different types of them, that were affected by the technology changes that occurred in the 16th century. And there's also a galleon, but I couldn't be able to get more information about it. But in any case, I presume that it has little to do with the galleons, dating from late 16th century, which was a vessel only used in the armies. The three areas used for shipbuilding concentrated in the northern coast of the Iberian Peninsula, which was reduced to two. The shipbuilding in the Mediterranean Sea was just used for trading purposes, but were not involved in the discoveries that occurred during that time. So in the northern Iberian Peninsula, vessels were used for trading, for fishing, and essentially they were the same. Naus, coming from the three provinces of the north,
para una determinada o única función, por lo que algunos autores han acuñado términos como de uso múltiple, polivalentes, uso multiuso.
Multi-purpose, so to say. As for Andalusia, I would highlight the use of caravels, which were used for exploring matters and for the armies as well. We know that although we don't know about the origins of the caravel, some people say or have some theories about its origins, but nothing has been proved, really.
de estas naves,
they were very much used in Portugal, for instance, in the first voyages to Africa, and exploring Guinea, for instance, slave trading and gold, transport of gold. But we don't really know when they started to be used, when this type of vessel started to be used. So in order to face new challenges, the Crown needed to use the existing industrial structures in the north and south of the Iberian Peninsula in order to make vessels both for local people and foreign countries. And since there was more and more trade going on overseas, it was clear that larger boats were necessary for more cargo and more passengers as well. So this is why two agreements would be drafted in 4 years. The first one dating from July 1494 in order to foster shipbuilding. The second dates from March 1498. Subsidies were given to people building ships from 16 to 100 tons. But the reality was quite different. There were three elements here. First, the high cost of having a fleet for the Crown. And here I'm going to explain this a little bit. Normally we use the terms fleet and armada. I tend to use fleet when I speak about trade, whereas I use the term armada or navy with a more military meaning. And the second reason here would be a consequence of not promoting the creation of shipbuilding facilities that were owned by the Crown. And the third element here we need to take into consideration is the high number of sites devoted to shipbuilding that were very profitable for the Crown and not so much for owners and for ship owners.
Por ser la navegación tanto de comercio como de pesca,
sostiene
la economía doméstica de
their industry was at the core of the domestic economy. Here we can add a high number of documents and papers in the archives that explain the situation. There was a problem there.
El documento notarial depositado en el archivo histórico
of expropriation and complaints occurred. One of them, for instance, was a complaint filed by Pedro de Arismendi, who complains for a forced expropriation of the now Santa Maria to be used the service of the king and queen in order to discover new land overseas by Magellan and Falero. So this problem to have more and more fleet was important and was solved by giving subsidies and having protective measures to favor national production. So in September 1500, there was a decree drafted whereby no cargo that would come from foreign countries could be loaded in local ships. There was a prohibition of selling vessels to foreign countries. This has been mentioned already by Javier.
Aunque tuvieran carta de naturaleza. Pero la realidad es que la
the truth is that this issue about the design and construction of vessels was still in the hands of private individuals. As we said, in 1492, a new policy of expansion started. There was a very large activity of exploration, colonization, which required administrative support. And this task was left in the hands of the what was called La Casa de Contratación de Indias, which was created in 1503 by the Catholic monarchs, aimed at ruling over everything related to the Indies. This system that belonged to the state administration and concerned new lands covered all the aspects you can think of related to sailing, voyages, etc., etc., so that all this information was not would not fall in the hands of foreign powers. This new structure was based on taxing the cargo that would come to Sevilla. Immigration was also subjected to a specific ruling, and little by little this system, this administration system had more and more powers, and there were so many people working for it, many civil servants, judges, officers, etc. There were many different positions there, and so this institution became one of the most complex one, and this turned Seville in the main port site of the overseas trade. This generated a large amount of activity based on trading and exploration of the new world, and enabled professionals of construction, mainly Basque, to establish themselves in the in these lands as carpenters, carpenters, etc., who would repair the vessels that were going to be traveling over to new land. When the new world was found, there were multiple voyages. The second one by Colón was in 1493. When Elcano came back in 1522, between both dates, at least 20 expeditions were carried out in 29 years, which reflects the high amount of human resources and vessels that were required. The nows and caravels were the vessels that were chosen to carry out this task, or this expansion. At least this is what we see in a number of different documents coming from expeditions where these type of vessels are mentioned. They were slightly small, since at the time a vessel over 70 tons was too large for exploration, since Cristóbal Colón was thought to have lost Santa María due to its large size. Early in the 16th century, the trend would be similar for a number of different reasons, quite simply because these type of vessels met the needs of ship owners. Or maybe they were ideal for this type of exploratory voyages, since their smaller size would avoid problems in unknown waters. The truth is that the units in the first quarter of the century were not beyond 130 tons. Let me mention some examples. The Nicolás de Obando Navy in 1502, made up by 24 caravels that had 30 to 90 tons. In the Castilla del Oro Navy, the caravels had 50 tons, and there was another caravel of 50. And finally, the one in Santa María de la Rábida, this is a vessel that could reach 130 tons, more or less. There was an expedition in October 1515 made up by three caravels. The smallest one had 35 tons and the other two 60 and 90 respectively. And out of the vessels that made up the Maluco Navy, we know that there Santiago vessel had 75 tons, 85 the Victoria now, and 90 the Concepcion now, and then finally San Antonio will have 120 tons.
Existen diversos documentos en el archivo de Indias entre los
que destacan dos cartas. We have two letters from the Spanish king, one in 1519, where Luis de Mendoza was appointed treasurer of the Armada, and it says, and they mention both naus and caravels in that document. Later on, they say once again, naus and caravelas, referring to the vessels. So that phrase, naus and caravels, appears once again in a letter written by the king that very year, where Antonio de Coca is appointed as registrar for the whole of the Armada, and once again the phrase naus and caravels is mentioned. So the fact that those two terms come together makes us think that it was not just naus sailing, but also caravels. And Fernández Duro, in his book The Spanish Armada, mentions this point as well. In 1519, when the ship sailed, for instance, he mentions how only naus is mentioned in that case, or in a different situation, only caravel is mentioned. And again, the minor St. James caravel.
Santiago,
together with Victoria and Concepcion, would be the ideal candidates to be considered as caravels and not naus. And yet, if we accept Domingo de Apayúa's document as right, the owner, the ship owner of now Santa Maria,
personal de esa correspondencia previa a la
and it would probably, in fact, refer to Victoria,
podría ser carabela.
Then it is mentioned how caravel is mentioned in that case.
De que fueran mayores de 60 toneles.
Really, the limit seems to be 60 toneles or casks, although that was not always respected. One more problem with typologies that came up during the Q&A session earlier on is the fact that different names and labels were given, even referring to one particular vessel at different times in different documents. They talk about naus, caravels, or galleons, or caracks. They just It's a huge mix-up, and that's probably due to the fact that there was not that clear a difference amongst those different terms. For instance, Fernández González, Barham, Phillips have all mentioned this terminological problem. And also other similar ships in other countries, we have this same terminological mix-up. For instance, Fernando Oliveira, the Portuguese author, at the end of the 16th century, mentions this problem, how in Germany they would call them urcas, in Italy caracks, in Spain naos, and so on. And again, another huge controversy is tons and casks, or toneles, that is the number of casks that the ship could hold as cargo. Documents at the beginning of the 16th century tell us about this quite clearly. Those documents complain about the lack of agreement about measurements and tonnage, and unfortunately I have no time to address this topic in detail, and I totally agree with Xavi Alberdi. There's a complete lack of consensus as to what we mean by tons or by toneles or casks.
Rumbo del tonel, que es el tonel puesto en pie,
There are different types of cask measurements depending on how the cask was standing on vertically on an end, and partly this mix-up is due to the fact that they wanted to pay less dues because they would have less casks, or they could hold less casks. We also have other documents to do with accounts, expropriation, trade agreements, repair agreements or bills. Those sources allow us to have information about the type of ship, the origin, the price to be paid depending on the number of casks, and so on. And that also gives us information about the conditions the vessel was in. Very often, about equipment, about the weapons they would take with them, about the crew, about the reasons for the armada to be prepared, about the privileges and rights that were given to the crew that went on these adventures. So, different authors have different hypotheses about what we mean by nau or caravel. Let me also mention how maritime and shipping museums often have models of these ships trying to be small-sized replicas, which are not always very accurate, according to the sources. Thanks to underwater archaeology, we now have a new source of information, so we can physically check at times of damage with other sources. Thanks to the wrecks that have been found, we can do so to a certain extent, although it's only a very small number, thinking about the thousands of ships and different typologies. For instance, Viking tradition, the Iberian tradition, or Mars, all those different types that have allowed us to go further in our understanding of shipbuilding, and like in the case of Pasayar as well.
Aún así, la sola aparición de un barco completo no es razón suficiente.
When a whole ship is found as a wreck, it's useful, although we shouldn't take it for granted that all other ships would follow that model. Different ships could have been built by the same team of carpenters at the same shipyard, and yet be completely different.
La documentación que conserva el Museo Naval de Madrid.
So, in the museum, for instance, in Madrid, we have very good information about 18th century ships, like Mazarredo, for instance, at the end of the 18th century.
He said comportamientos diferentes, achacándolo a la propia construcción.
That
esta línea. Clariana Walves,
construction techniques mattered. And then Clariana Walves said in 1735, it's so difficult to... shipbuilding is so difficult that you can't really have two ships that are completely identical. So let's go back to the 15th and 16th century. Let's think about those rules about the numbers, 1, 2, 3, the different techniques.
Aunque no siempre los barcos obedecían exactamente a ellas, por lo que escalaban.
But once again, those were just guidelines, not rules, as Escalante de Mendoza said.
También se unen las alusiones a los tratados de construcción naval.
We also have mentioned to the treaties for shipbuilding.
Se ignoran. La primera responde al espacio temporal.
And yet again, then again, those rules were often ignored. The first treaty in Spain was written in 1575. You can imagine, very late, and at the time of transition.
So
that is the shaky basis that research needs to understand. So let's now talk about those treaties, their nature, and let's wonder if they were realistic or if authors were just expressing opinions and as something different from the real world. So, I'm not saying that I see clearly that I know the answer to that question, but I do know that those authors of the treaties were not shipbuilders, and shipbuilders often didn't write. They couldn't even write. They were often illiterate. So, we're talking about two different extremes, and we often think that they would closely follow mathematical and geometrical formulae, but that was not the case. The practice was much more empirical, based on proportions and scale, and often on trial and error. The iconic information we have is quite abundant compared to the other two sources of information I mentioned.
So,
texts and archaeology would mostly study architecture and shipbuilding, whereas iconic documents would concentrate on design and shapes. So, when I talk about iconic sources, I'm talking about sculpture, drawings, paintings, tapestries, coins, jewelry, and so on. These are manifestations that are very rich in detail, and yet we have to be careful to understand or interpret they were technically accurate. Because those authors and craftsmen were not specialists in shipbuilding and would often be ignorant about details and the relevance of those details. Also, we should understand that iconic information often repeats a model time and time again. For instance, the Atlas by Nicolas Vallard from 1547. We can see a drawing with all these different ships that look almost identical, with hardly any difference from one to the rest. Then there is the piece by Alejo Fernández that we can see up on the screen, The Sailor's Virgin, which is meant to tell us about what ships looked like at the time. This piece is now in Seville. It has been dated between 1531 and 1536. It's meant to be the earliest painting about the discovery of America. And you can see that behind the main characters, we see some of the indigenous population, including what is meant to be the first portrait, posthumous, in fact, of Christopher Columbus. I'm just saying that as a curiosity.
Aquí veremos en el paño central una gran embarcación.
You see, in the middle, that big vessel, a large vessel that seems to be almost not in the water. You will agree with me that that's not a natural portrayal of shipping. And let me read my text again. So, this ship doesn't look very natural at all. You can also see a very confusing portrayal of... the front, really, it should be much more angular, it should project forward much more than it does. That stern is...
Generalmente del ámbito mediterráneo, no al
bow is far too flat.
Idea, esto casa más con una carraca, de las que
I hope you agree with me. This vessel looks much more like an Italian carrack, nothing like it now. Later on, I will explain my hypothesis for this. You can see on the side panel with San Telmo.
Aquí lo vemos. Bueno, el retablo que es
a ship on his hand. And then we have the central panel and the side panels that include the saint with that tiny vessel, which is really a small copy of the larger ship. The only difference in this case is that the stern is nice and round with the belt. This panel also includes other vessels, including on the lower right, you see there.
Este barco es sumamente sospechoso que se encuentra.
This is a highly suspect vessel, I call it, with features that look very much like Venetian gondolas from the beginning of the 16th century, where you see gondolas not as we know them now, where the ferro di proa,
inicialmente no las hay. También, bueno,
the bow was very different at that time.
Timonel, que se encuentra a la popa, ya, pues,
also,
delata una similitud pues muy muy próxima.
You can see
cuadros de Carpaccio, por ejemplo.
Very aquí close similarities to, for instance, Carpaccio's painting.
Mantiene el equilibrio paintings. De Timonel a su popa.
You can
es
see
muy similar,
how. At the bow, the person who's punting is protecting the travelers. And then the banana shape that was very typical at that time for these vessels, which became much more thinner over the years. But look at that hull, how it's only held by a very small amount of central structure.
Este punto
so,
refleja un hecho de la prudencia con la que debe ser estudiada la iconografía.
I'm saying all of this to remind us all that we need to be very careful when interpreting iconic sources. Do they reflect a reality or an ideal or a repeated model? I'm not saying they're not valid sources, but we need to just use them to have a general idea of the image of, or the appearance of the vessels in this case.
Con los altos relieves de San Nicolás de Burgos.
We have, for instance, Saint Nicholas in Burgos, Diego de Rivero, Giovanni Vespucci, the altarpiece at in Zumaya here in the Basque Country, other authors, both Spanish and Italian, for instance, Carpaccio, Francesco Rosselli, Sandro Botticelli, or Francesco di Giorgio.
Presumimos que hicieron de cartógrafos en los que
representan. So, some of these sailors at that time would have also contributed to cartography, to portrayal of the vessels during their voyages with their drawings.
Si en verdad esto así lo es.
And yet, look at these images. Was this close to reality? Well, many of the replicas that have been done during the 19th century and the earliest 20th century were on the basis of iconic sources. This is a cartographic image. And those of you who are familiar with sailing and ships,
you can probably
understand that the difference between a drawing that's realistic and the rest. Very often doing an approximate portrayal. Only approximate and very patchy portrayal. So, let me tell you about ex-votos. The Mataró Now, or Catalan Now, which according to Marcel Pujol helps to know better what a middle-aged ship looked like inside. And then the Utrera ex voto as well. Here it is, on the left the Mataró Now, and then on the right the Utrera ex voto. Well, this is a unique example where we see the transformation from a merchant ship that would have sailed the Atlantic Ocean to and now in the Armada. I'm very sorry, this is my daughter and I forgot to silence my phone. And she's a bit of a pest.
Respecto al modelo de, al modelo de, de Utrera.
So, I personally think the Mataró case was made by a craftsman who knew the hell of a lot about shipbuilding, or the other way around, but somebody who really knew what he was doing. Whereas the Utrera ex voto, that was found by Admiral Villentato in the Consolación Church in Utrera, down south in Spain, and then it was taken to Seville, to the museum there, and that's when a priest said, unfortunately, it had been thrown in the into the fire, as firewood. That was back in 1927, but fortunately he had taken two, he said, good pictures. Only one of those pictures is preserved at the museum now, and then on the basis of that picture and some measurements that Admiral Guillen had taken, that's how the model was made.
So,
we're talking about 1540, that would have been, that would be the dating for that vessel, supposedly. And I published an article, a paper, in Cuadernos de Arqueología, the journal, where I have taken the model down figuratively to pieces in great detail. And I concluded that it would be clearly a Basque ship.
Se corresponderían ni más ni menos que con las que están.
Although the actual mock-up or model that was made looks nothing like that. This ship was tuned to change from a merchant ship to a military ship. You can see how the bow looks much less medieval.
Y vemos que hay como dos elementos distintos, ¿no? Francisco Fernández González, él llega a decir sobre esta.
And Francisco González, in fact, said, mentioned how that bow looks very much like a box, and that couldn't be right in the original. So excavations in Iberia has also given us information on the Iberian tradition, both the Spanish and Portuguese traditions. And during the exploration voyages, we haven't found very much wood for those examples.
Esto plantea un problema a la hora de hacer frente a una hipotética restitución de
so,
las formas.
When we talk about replicas on the basis of the findings,
que por ausencia física ha de ser resuelta mediante la mesa o en la mesa de dibujo o del ordenador. A ello se le une el continuo baile de cifras respecto a las unidades de peso y de medida.
So, we have different differences as well and lack of accuracy in the measurements.
Cuestión esta que también supone un problema.
We very rarely know where the ships were built.
De los que no hay, salvo excepciones, identificación documental de ellos. Por ejemplo,
we have very, very few documents.
Well,
that's not the case for someone. Fortunately, Salma Huxley found the document, fortunately for that. And then that's a lot for the replica.
Salvo lo que podemos.
So its origin is not easily
findable.
We can now know from other fields that the remains are adapted. And the information we come from the remains enables archaeologists to draw conclusions about structure, the structure of Atlantic wrecks. And this leads to a new concept, which is Iberian Atlantic vessels, or the term Iberian Atlantic tradition is also coined here. This matter has been dealt with many times with a number of different researchers like Leuven, Oertling and Castro mainly, and this is why we're not going to go into detail. We're just going to carry out a very shallow review of the features, and we will talk about also about Mediterranean ships in order to make a comparison between the two. The idea of Iberian construction enables us to make a difference between the vessels on the basis of the origin, the one vessels linked to a geographical area located between Vizcaya and Gipuzkoa, the Portuguese area and the Catalan area. And we're mainly going to use two origins, Atlantic and the Mediterranean, in order to make a difference between the vessels. We're going to be mentioning very quickly here the main features of these wrecks, where we can find a number of different elements. The first one has to do with timber. In the Basque areas, there were many European oak tree forests, which were used for shipbuildings, for larger or smaller boats. Oak trees are the main reference in shipbuilding in the northern area of the Iberian Peninsula. But let's not forget the use of these species in Mediterranean vessels. Like, for instance, in Mortella III wreck or in Sveti Pavao and Calvi and Lomelina and Cavoli, a merchant tree probably with the Catalan origin, although it's not covered in this study due to its date. This timber was very much used in shipbuilding. although its varieties were many different to the ones we now have in the area. The Portuguese shipbuilding was mainly using cork tree to build vessels of more than 1,000 tons. In the 16th century, oak tree timber was imported probably from Galicia and northern Morocco. In the Iberian Peninsula area, in the area of the Mediterranean of the Iberian Peninsula, we don't have many wrecks. And here, mainly, home oak was used, and probably coming from high mountains that were taken that were taken from the high mountains to ship building facilities using rafts. Let me mention here a binome. Timber and fatok. I'm going to be showing you a drawing here where you don't see any nails or tree nails. It means that I don't really know how they were used, in what pattern they were used. So I'm going to be mentioning the binome fatok and floor timber, where we can see two constant elements, the fastening
combinados o no con el cabillado de madera.
Pattern or dovetail unions. In this case, iron nails were used combined with tree nails in many cases. Let me look at Mediterranean vessels where floor timber and fatoks were joined together using iron nails with a round section.
No se constata el uso de cabillas.
We don't see the use of tree nails in Mediterranean vessels, at least not in this period of time, whereas in the northern or Atlantic area they were used. There was a combination, the combination of both used, and there are cases like, for instance, I can't remember now the name, the cutterwater, I believe he said, where only tree nails were used, no iron nails were used at all.
Fine.
João Bautista Lavanda would say early 17th century that tree nails were only used in cold water sailing vessels, whereas in the rest of the cases the iron nails were used. The dovetail joint mortise is mainly linked to the Atlantic area, but it's also used in some cases in the Mediterranean vessels, like for instance in Lo Melina wrecks, and it could have been also used in a marinier wreck, but this is not something I can ratify here. So this is the foundation for us to maybe think of a possible exchange of technologies in both seas, which can be ratified by the Venetian wreck Calvi that combines both elements that are typical from the Mediterranean and the Atlantic vessels. So this likely technology transfer can also be seen in Caisosogre wreck, which you can see here, which has been traditionally considered to be a Portuguese vessel, but it could be a vessel built in Mediterranean Sea. It has the dovetail mortise, of course, which is traditional to Iberian Atlantic vessels, but also wooden tree nails were used. The home tree was used as well, but other timber was also used coming from the Mediterranean area. I can add here that there is a very interesting piece of research available in the network by a Catalan author, Enrique Jué, where he provides data where this cultural relationship can be proved. It's a very nice reading if you're interested in this topic. So, as for the bottom of Atlantic boats, so they're more straight and like the Mediterranean vessels, which are more round, which are typical from Italy and Portugal. I've just been told that I've run out of time, which means that I need to stop here. I hope my presentation was interesting to you all. That's all from me. And if there are any questions from the floor, of course, I'd be very happy to answer them. Thank you.
¿Alguna cuestión?
Questions from the floor?
Good
morning, thank you very much. I have a question about what you said. I can hear you very well. When you spoke about the typology of vessels used for exploring purposes, the smaller vessels that were sent first are called patache or patache, Santiago, San Juan, Sanlúcar. Can you talk us about them? Well, the first thing the only thing we know about the patache, and we don't have much information about that on the papers, we know this term by Manuel Fernández's book dating from 1916, where there is a drawing in detail. As for this Navarran sailor, Carlos Cetallo, that sailed on the vessel La Niña, too, and he's published some work, and he says that probably now Victoria was not a nao, but rather a patache, since in a number of different documents, together with the Santiago, they're the ones that are sent first for exploration. So the only thing I can tell you about it is that it's very hard to know what they actually were, and it is even more difficult to know what a patache was within this philosophy of Spanish or Iberian shipbuilding, and more specifically in the field of the remains we now have. We don't know what it is. We know it existed, but that's all we know. In order to broaden my answer, I would say I still had four sheets of paper to read to you in order to finish my presentation, but it is true that the minor vessels were used both for fleet and navies. They were all called vessels, and there you had a number of different types of ships that might not be mentioned on the texts, since they were minor vessels. And that's all I can tell you about it. Thank you.
Al mencionar la fecha,
you mentioned 1492 as the turning point of the overseas expansion. Somehow we're ignoring both the voyages carried out by Ferrer, Lancelot, Mallorca. Can you turn on your mic? We cannot hear you very well.
Sí, mencionar me parece
I think that it is quite daring to use 1492 as the turning point in overseas exploration, because in doing so, we're ignoring all the Portuguese voyages and the discovery, which is important, of the route to Africa. By Bartolomé Díaz, and you're ignoring as well the voyages from Majorca to the Canary Islands, etc., etc. That on the one hand, and on the other hand, placing Andalusia versus the Mediterranean Sea and the Atlantic Sea, well, I see it more like a geostrategic position, depending on tides and winds, and also due to an element of avoiding piracy in the 16th century. On the other hand, there is a political element here, which is that the Aragon crown was considered to be a foreign kingdom, and therefore the monopoly of Seville was in the hands of the Kingdom of Castile, and this was true until the dynasty changed. Well, let me try and answer your question. Well, using 1492 as a turning point, and as you said, well, it's true that it's useful, but it's not based on data that provide us information with a beginning or an end to anything at all. I mean, whether we like it or not, the fact that Christopher Columbus and his vessels went to America is the starting point of it's a new era, really. A change from the Middle Ages to the Modern Ages. This is why I'm using this very same date in my presentation. Of course, knowing that there are many routes and exploratory voyages that are going on, but the greatest leap was actually the voyage carried out by Columbus. In terms of sailing the Dark Sea, and this had an impact at a global level. And if you don't use this date, I think you're not very good at history, or naval history at least.
No sé, sí.
Yo quisiera preguntar.
I would like to ask you about the slide we're now seeing, for example, that use of dovetail mortise. Is it something consistent in these vessels? I mean, I see, for instance, that there are different types corresponding to the same vessel. Probably there are different types of joint. Some vessels will only have one or two of them. Yes, that's right. That's right. This is just reference.
I
would have liked to show you some pictures of the wrecks themselves, where you see these joints in detail. But I say in detail in inverted commas. This is why I didn't use the images and the pictures, because in some cases you need to have a lot of imagination to see them. So after years of studying this and analyzing the work by different authors, I came up with this drawing. Well, it was my daughter who drew all these joints. This is just a reference. It's a very simple sketches of the joints in an abstract way, of course. And of course, many joints appear in a recurrent way because they're based on exactly the same thing. The joints may be placed at a point, a given point, or a different place in floor timbers, because things are not that precise, right? There's no such high accuracy in shipbuilding.
refería también un poco
a todas las cuadernas. I also meant whether the all. I would like to ask whether all the frames have this pattern, this joint. Well, that's another problem, and this is part of the end of my presentation, which I couldn't read. A problem we have with works is that what we have from them is just the remains, and normally we have. We have parts of them, parts of the underwater body mainly, and there are, for instance, three different types of joints we know, the ones that overlap or the ones that don't. Well, you know, here it's not the same joints. And this is not the same thing we see, for instance, in red base wreck, where
the floor timber are joined
together. So, so if you have equal problems, you need to have equal solutions.
No,
I don't know.
We
don't really know.
Si que hay una cierta relación
but there is a relationship between the Atlantic system with this specific system and the Mediterranean system.
No puedo decir más.
That's all I can say. We don't know if all parts are exactly the same. We have, in some cases, many different parts of some wrecks. But when you excavate, you don't really know whether this is the stern or this is the bow. We just have hypotheses. And you need to. Have a lot of imagination in order to know how or what the vessel actually looked like. But there's nothing that is certain here. This is just about hypotheses and about small elements we have about vessels. And we've taken things from here and from there and pieces from here and there. And using the computer, we've put things together and we've built our own Frankenstein, as Mary Shelley would put it. If you take the reconstructions of vessels that have nothing to do with historical events and you interpret what the authors are telling us, for instance, in terms of Columbus's vessels or the now Victoria that is still sailing, and I believe it was here, recently, if you look at everything that's been published, you'll be surprised. And I could even say, or I could even reproduce what the author of the book that that speaks about this reconstruction. We took elements from the Basque whaler, from the Hull from Bremen, from the Nau from Mataró, from Utrera's wreck. We took from the, some elements from the Mary Rose, etc., etc. So let's sort things out because we're mixing up traditions here. We're mixing times here. The times that are completely different, elements that were very different, like for instance the timber used by some other some people and other people, and this is so. I mean, this is our situation here. We're mixing all these things together, we're putting them in the mixer, and we come up with a theory. And that's it. And what's left in our mind is this, the final conclusion. And this is, as I said earlier, when we say now and we say caravelle, we all know what it is. We know what a caravelle is. And nevertheless, there's not a single now that we have in full. I mean, we don't have a complete caravelle. And if you think this is not so, come here and show me the vessel. We don't know what they look like because we don't have a full vessel, a full caravelle. There are many elements missing, many structural elements missing in order to guarantee that actually the vessel is as we think it is, as it was originally. Does it mean that all these theories are useless? Of course not. Science evolves, it's moving forward, and it enables us to have theories and to have an idea of what the vessels look like. And little by little, we're moving forward on the basis of small discoveries, tiny little discoveries. Everything counts.
eso estamos.
And that's what we're doing.
Lo que no podemos es dar como válido algo.
But of course we cannot think that something that's not valid is actually true. Yes, there are things that are missing. Of course, this is like the DNA sequence that was missing in Jurassic Park. You have a DNA sequence missing, you put some DNA from a frog and that's it. No, this may seem funny, but this is what we've been doing for centuries, at least for a century. Here we're just trying to work on the basis of actual evidence, and we need to be very careful here. In any case, what we do is very valuable because this is a heritage we're going to be leaving to the next generation of researchers, builders, archaeologists, etc., mock-up builders, etc., etc., because they've made a contribution as well, so let's not forget them. But currently what we have is what we have, and that's it. We have a great question mark above our heads, and we're trying to provide answers and move forward and have an idea of how the things were in the past.
¿Alguna otra pregunta?
Any more questions, maybe?
Gracias, Xavier.
Thank you, Xavier.
Si no hay nada más, muchísimas gracias.
Thank you very much for your attention.